Welcome to the STABcast, a podcast dedicated to Star Wars Legion.
I wish I could put my fist through this whole lousy, beautiful town.
Welcome, cadets and commanders, to the STABcast, the Sunsphere Tactical Attack Brigade's Star Wars Legion podcast. I'm Ryan, talk sarcastically, Slowoski, joined by Ben, talk grammatically correct, Fowler, Tim, talk angry, Hannon, and by none other than Lj, talk polite, Peña. How are we doing this week, fellas?
Doing good, doing good.
Doing good, thank you.
This week on STABcast, battle reports, more red player dilemmas, and a look at the LVO, and so much more.
This week on our battle reports, I'm talking about my Yavin-based team league final week of play. So this came down, I think, to we were not going to be the top, but possibly we get into third, fourth. I don't know. Ryan actually manages the standings.
Yeah, we were fighting for a top four spot.
Okay, so we were fighting hard. I'm playing against Madman Rambler, who I played in the last Discord league and had a great time with him. I beat him. It was close. I beat him last time, so he was gunning for me a little hard. I'm running an AT-ST, three sniper strike teams, five storms with DLT, and Veers. And I'm pretty sure I have recon intel on like everything that can take it.
Yep, you did. It was very strange.
Rambler's running Leia, Luke, two sniper strikes, two fleets with all the business, and three rebels with some Zs. So my master plan is I'm going to shoot everything from 1,000 yards away and either scare them away or make sure they just don't get any range to touch me. That's my master plan. And then turn zero happened, and the plan completely fell apart.
Yep, as it does.
As it does, as it does.
So the real problem, and it's not a problem, the thing is the map didn't help me at all. It's a beautiful map. It's Vader's shuttle pad. It's got some lava and the lambda sitting on top of it. But it's got this huge center island rock formation on top of which sits a giant lambda shuttle. And there's no way for me to shoot long range on anything. There's enough obstructions on the side where you just can't see them. And so there's only one alleyway where he and I can look at each other at range four or greater. And so I put everything over there that I can because the plan is to shoot them before you can touch anything. We end up playing recover supplies. That's what we intend to go for. I have to end up going to battle lines. And I don't know because I think I could have gone major offensive, but I thought that wouldn't help me. We went with hostile because I couldn't afford to let limited visibility because my plan is to shoot everything at range. As they advance, let's just shoot them in the face. And so I deploy on some edges. He mostly deploys on his right side, which means I'm kind of sitting in the alleyway. My AT-ST sets up right next to Veer so I can get all the aim tokens. I got a trooper squad just to keep Veers alive because he has to be in the open in order to do these things. Two snipers over there. And from moment one, so turn zero was bad. Turn one, it just fell apart. Leia throws all the hits. I can't dodge anything. Veer's attack does, I think, a single damage. I get all four hits, but I only get a single damage out of it. I lose two, 1.5 set of snipers real early, so that turns off quite terrible. It just keeps getting worse and worse from turn one. I was like, well, in desperation, I just got to push up the center. But between fleets and Luke, it's a game I'm going to lose because I'm geared for distance, not for up close and personal. I have no flamethrowers on me, yep. And it just turns out bad, just so bad. His defense dice worked really well for him. My attack dice were pretty fine. Like mathematically they're where they should be, but I just couldn't overcome the fact that I had to get close. Cause getting close is bad for fleets. It's bad for Luke. Now Madman was cool about it. We played out the rest of the game, but it was done by round three. I just wanted to murder something with an AT-ST. Didn't.
So what you're saying is you took all the advice that we have culminated in our archives of 16 episodes of the STABcast. You threw it out the window and played a game and lost.
No, the plan worked. On a different map, the plan would have worked fine. It was very map dependent. He had a list that worked beautifully with that map. I see it's a great looking map. It's just I wasn't the one I planned on seeing. Of all the other maps I saw, that was not the one I thought was going to be the one that was going to get me. So, yeah. Like I said, the fight over the center box was the one. I mean, but, you know, my AT-ST rode on. It rides now, a road for ruin, and the world's ending. And then the world ended, so. Ryan, how was your Yavin-based team league?
Yeah, so we're taking this back a little bit because I haven't gotten to play a ton of Legion since our last episode. And I think it's important to... There's a few important things to note in my also finals game. I got to play GB Moore in the Yavin-based team league. He was rocking a very aggressive 8-point bid. I was running a 6-point bid, so I was a little sad that I got sniped. But it was General Veers, Boba Fett, 6 cores, triple sniper team. So no bikes, but lots and lots of snipers. I was running basically the same list I've been playing in tournament play lately, which is Han, Luke, Chewie, 5 cores, and a sniper team for taste. One of those cores being the fleet troopers with scatters and concussions.
Do you have Z6s on those?
I had Z6s on one. One of my trooper groups was a frag and Z6 squad. Two of them were 5-man teams, and then one of them was a 4-man team. And then I had the fully loaded fleets.
I think the internet's about to tell you that you're wrong about that.
All right, well, I won my game and you lost yours. So bring it on, internet. Bring it on. So we played Disarray because it's my favorite. And he had to push some other battle cards around to try to not to get limited visibility, since even though I had one set of snipers, he had 3. I was more than ready to let limited visibility happen, because I want to say we had limited visibility, hostile environment, and rapid reinforcements. And so he had to spend his time getting to hostile environment because it was the one that shut him down the least, because you don't want fleet troopers jumping in your back door, especially with the list that he played. And so as we start deploying, I start to go for a little bit more of a balanced approach between my 2 deployment zones because I have 2 commanders. I can do that. But I quickly get the impression that he's only going to put Boba Fett alone in the one corner, kind of away from most of our objectives. We had the box in the middle. And then I had put my 2 boxes kind of out in one on each of the deployment zones. And he had put both of his in a parallel line as close as they could to his deployment zone. It's not a bad play. It clustered everything kind of in one little triangle between some rock formations on the Endor map on the tabletop simulator. And so I managed to put my 4-man little babysitter squad, Luke and my fleet troopers in one corner, and the whole rest of my army led by Han and Chewie in another. And he puts everything in one corner except for Boba Fett. And he kind of tipped his hand a little early that he was going to do this by placing his scouts a bit earlier than I thought he maybe should have, because I honestly thought he was going to put his scouts with Boba over there and just make me kind of deal with him. But he padded them with the rest of his army because he wanted Veers to be able to give them tokens if need be, which I get. But it was literally Boba out on a line. And so turn 1, I kind of advance, do the rebel thing, advance, take dodge tokens, hide in some cover. I get the box with my rebel troopers relatively easily. And I'm lucky enough that I draw my fleet troopers and Luke very late. So I get to kind of see how the play is going to develop and where they need to go, whether they need to go towards the middle of the map to contest Boba, or whether they need to cut across the long edge of the map to hit his back line on Disarray, which is kind of, I split the difference and I sent my fleets along the back edge. And when he drew his Boba Fett relatively early, he got a little greedy and double moved him, which is fine, but he moved him on a beeline to the box when what he probably should have done is moved him to where exactly one more move action would have put him on the box. When the position he put himself, he could have done like a speed 2 move to get to the box, and it put him a little too close to Luke.
Now, faithful listeners, you'll see that we actually cast this on Twitch last weekend. Tim and I were commentating, and we barely made it in because for some reason I had to reinstall Tabletop Simulator real fast. And Tim and I were both looking for Luke and these fleet troopers. We knew they were somewhere on the table, but they were kind of hiding in the corner. And Tim and I were also very surprised about Boba. Makes sense by himself. He can survive. He's not going to get scared off the table.
Right,
and we thought, oh, he's just going to play hell in the backfield. Maybe he's going to pincer on Ryan's flank for Disarray. Yeah. And it didn't happen. Tim and I were kind of surprised. Like, we were trying to figure out what his plan was. He had a plan. It just wasn't the plan that Tim and I were thinking about.
Once Luke came out of the bushes there, and I'm sure he saw Luke get placed there, we just didn't see it. And knowing Luke was there, I just, That was real bold to blame up there.
Well, the other kind of opportunity, not to poo-poo on BG Moore, because he's a good guy, and he was probably, of all my team league games, like one of the most fun, friendly players to play with. I kind of thought what he was going to do with his Boba Fett is he just gunned him in for the middle box. But I just had a four-man trooper squad in heavy cover, just kind of hanging out with to get my box. And that's all that was really there to go after him. And Boba didn't go for him. I thought he would go murder them, pick up their box, go to the middle, pick up that box. And then he'd have two boxes on Boba Fett, who I can't catch because he's so lightning fast. Especially with Boba's sharpshooter 2 ignoring that heavy, those heavy woods that I had my troopers situated in.
Yeah.
But he got a little greedy with his Boba play, and Luke, with four moves and two leaps, managed to get into base-to-base contact. And we go into turn two, and he plays whipcord, as you do when you know that your Boba's probably about to get latched on by Luke, and I drop a change of plans instead of going straight into Son of Skywalker. Because he saw me, you know, that's the one thing I actually kind of hate about Tabletop Simulator, is I hate that your opponent can see you measuring things. I want an incognito measurement mode, so you don't know what I'm measuring.
Speaking of that, Twitch podcasters would love to have that same measuring node, because Tim and I, like,
oh, I know.
Think it's range 3. Maybe it's range 3. I don't know. Can we measure with thumbs?
You just got to put your thumb up, and then if you put it on the screen, it'll be 4 thumbs up. That's range 1.
Oh, exactly. Gotcha.
That's right.
Gotcha. All right. getting the pro tips from LJ. But yeah, he got his Boba caught out, and dice happened. He had some pretty good dice in our earlier exchanges, where kind of his big army stepped out to shoot my big army. His was much bigger than mine on that one flank of Veers versus Han. Yes. He got some good dice, but then the dice kind of evened out, and Luke managed, through Son of Skywalker, to put Boba down in two attacks. And so they basically gave me control of 2/3 of the table, and two of the boxes were 100% mine.
And here's the thing. Though that happens at the start of turn 3, Tim and I both think BG Moore still has this game. Like, we really think Ryan is dead up until about round 5.
Yeah, it was a very good game.
He had the firepower. Oh, yeah, it was a very good game. Yep. BG Moore had the firepower. He was knocking units dead left and right. Luke was always a worry. Yep. He was, except for board control. I mean, Ryan's right. He had about 2/3 of the board by himself. Everything was concentrated on the 1/3 on BG Moore's left.
Yeah, and the thing BG Moore had going for him is I sent another one of what I call my babysitter squads out to go grab a box, kind of just and be safe. And he used his snipers to pick them off, and some DLTs to pick them off, so they never actually got to the box. I think they were taken out by the end of turn 1.
They were.
But what that led me to do, though, is I had one sniper team. He had 3. By the end of turn 3, I won the sniper war. Somehow. I wrestled my fleets up into some trees, and they got to kind of force the fight down on Veers and his back lines, and they actually got one of the commando squads. And I think he put a little too much pressure on my fleets, a little too many actions into them, when he should have been shooting and moving instead of aiming and shooting to make sure they're dead. And granted, they did have some decent defense dice, but what really kept him pinned back from contesting the middle of the board while Han walked up to get into range to do kind of Han things.
That's what I was saying, is that as an Imperial player, I understand that fleets are scary. I get that. And you want to kill them. Yes. I get it. You don't want them on your flank. Absolutely. 100% get it. But he overcommitted to that.
Yeah, and the I would
dice
agree.
Again, he didn't necessarily do it all wrong. Some of the dice screwed up, but when the dice started screwing him up, he didn't switch tactics. And he just kept trying to kill that fleet, and held him up.
The big difference maker, I think, is if you think back to chess, and I'm not a great chess player, but one of the first things you learn is how to develop your board, how to get your pieces where you need them, not to win, but just to have the most use, to have the most flexibility. Developing your pawns out, getting your bishops like out from being stuck behind places. And I felt that's kind of what BG Moore forgot to do, is develop his board. Because when we started getting into those crucial rounds, the end of turn 4, the end of turn 5, he still hadn't claimed his boxes, because he had just wanted to stay back and aim and shoot. And he was winning the firepower fight. I was winning the box fight.
And the box fight is the one that counts.
The box fight's the ones that count. I got my loot kind of put in a sticky situation at one point. I threw him up on a hill, kind of overlooking the rest of BG Moore's army, trying to make him think I was going to jump down on top of him. But I was like, you know what? Luke's in heavy cover. He's got a dodge token. I just want him to stand here so he doesn't shoot my rebel troopers that are going to grab this box. And he did. He 100% took the bait, which was great for me because Luke is a scary piece. And if he does ignore him, there's a chance I leap down that hill and lightsaber some stuff up. But then Luke rolled defense dice and they were just all blanks. I think Luke took 5 damage and 5 attacks with heavy cover. And just he wasn't getting more than 1 or 2 hits through, but Luke could not spend couldn't roll a block to save his life. It was really kind of sad. And so I had to inevitably hide Luke, but his mission had been accomplished. I had once again kept him pinned back to where I could jump on him. He did a great job of locking my Han Solo down in melee twice after I would get him out. But you know what the problem with that was is I had a Z6 and frag squad who came up and, all right, well, you've locked down my Luke. You've locked down my Han. Well, I guess these guys will just go and throw, and you've been shooting my fleets. So by the top of turn 5, I got these guys kind of in the thick of things, and they managed to, on the last 2 turns, do some pretty significant damage. And he never really left his corner. So the reason I want to bring this game up is don't forget when you're playing these games, even if you're playing kind of like Ben's list, these long range specialist lists, these lists that want to make it come to you, even if you've got your eyes set on just 3 of the 5 boxes, don't forget to develop your board. Because I think if BG Moore in that same circumstance with that same list, I thought I was dead. The way the Yavin-based Team League format works, I thought this was probably the worst matchup I could have drawn. His list was a very good counter to mine. But because he didn't develop his board state, and I would always count his actions, because once again, we're playing hostile environment, that he was always 2 actions away from picking up that box. And that's all I had to keep him was 2 actions away because he wasn't going to get 2 actions. And then he ran out of time. He didn't run out of bodies. Like I think I had like 6 or 7 models left on the table when the game ended, but he just ran out of time before the game ended. So that's something that you really need to keep in mind, and not the time on the clock, but just activation time. So always be counting your activations. And even if you don't want to commit to the objectives too early, at least go stand next to them, even if you're not going to take that claim action. Just so at a moment's notice, you can grab that box if you need to. LJ, have you gotten to play any remarkable games that you wish to purvey upon our listeners?
I don't know if I've really gotten to play any remarkable games recently, because between setting up for this and getting ready for the next thing, the time has been limited. And I gotta say, you know, we're on the subject of YBTL, which I did play in. My last game was extremely uneventful, and I hate to say it, but I just absolutely destroyed Jay from Fifth Trooper. Just
awesome.
Just, and it wasn't like actually his fault. It was just that the goats that I sacrificed before the game were sufficient enough.
Yeah.
Just his army just folded, and it was bad.
If you can also review for our listeners which other podcast team you got to play and what the score of that series was.
Well, we did play a game against this podcast team, and I emerged victorious from my game.
You did.
But yes, we did go 1-2 in that series.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For our listeners at home, Brett was our third teammate between me and Ben. Tim, I don't think had the time to commit to a long league. Brett did go 0-4 for our team. So good job, Brett. Way to go.
Yep. He did all right, but it was I think that was another one where I just kind of outpositioned and then took over the board state from that one. But the game against Jay was just from the start, you could tell like, oh, yep, this is how this game is going to go. And then
I didn't know red dice had that many blank sides. Yeah. How's that possible?
I got to check these red dice. TTS is cheating me. And then there was a game. I actually did get 2 games in this weekend after LVO.
Awesome.
One on Saturday versus my Marshall Brendan. And I like to bring this game up because, you know, everybody's mentally just pasted from that weekend. I brought my Adepticon list, which is, you know, fairly competitive. but I had also gotten some swag on Friday, and I wanted to put all the swag on the table. So I played a Vader Boba no disintegrations list, which is fairly straightforward. Just Vader Boba, 6 DLT stormtroopers, nice and easy. And I wanted to play with all my new cards and stuff that I had gotten. And he had brought out a pretty standard Veers Boba list in response. And it was a big uphill battle for me that was actually a little closer than I thought it was going to be. But he beat me in that game, and then I played a game against another person who actually was at LVO and was playing a double SAB list, and they were full squads of saboteurs. And, you know, okay. I had played against Nick's triple SAB strike team list, and him and I played a game that came down to a dice roll. But I actually got pretty Rickrolled by this list, too. So if you want to beat me, play triple SABs or double SABs, because I don't know how to beat it.
Apparently. All right. I don't know how to play it. So what does this look like? Because I don't have a ton of experience with saboteurs, but in all of my experience, I kind of feel like it requires your opponent to like step on a rake and then fall down a well and make like 15 errors in a row for the saboteurs to really be worth their weight. So speak to me the secrets of the saboteurs.
Well, I think the first bonus was that they were Imperial saboteurs, so they're clearly the clearly the superior version of the saboteur. And you know, the big thing that they have going for them is the new ways to motivate them trick, where you know so the way Nick does it is he does the three strike teams, two of them get the new ways order token, and the third one has a HQ uplink. So then all three squads get the effect of new ways, and they can throw a bomb in the middle of your deployment zone on the first round. That's the real – and the way he plays them straight kamikaze style, where he will run them in, detonate, run it in, detonate, run it in, detonate, and essentially feeds you 130 points of his army turn one. But
didn't he get 52 suppression tokens out of that? Is that the record I saw?
So not in my game, no. But yes, he did have a pretty fantastic combined explosion and Master of Evil turn. I did see it. It was pretty impressive. But the way that this other guy played was he actually did the new ways to give them the extra movement, and then also put recon intel on the scout teams. So they did. Okay. And so this was also partially my fault, too. I let him get advanced positions. So you could tell that my brain was not working after LVO, because I let him get advanced positions with this list. So he had a free speed 3 move at the start of the game, and then did the new ways to get the free move towards me, then chucked the bomb, then did the free move back then did the regular move back, and then used his own regular move back to trigger the bomb going off.
Yep.
Okay.
I dig it. So, Bruce, you know, I like it. I'm kind of glad that I've seen that level of jank, because now I know if I see it at Adepticon, I know exactly how to counter it now. So I'm okay with this.
That's fair.
This is okay. That's fair. I was very happy to get my ass kicked by a community member right after LVO. It was good.
Right.
So those would be my two picks, I guess. A slaughter against Jay and myself getting essentially ran off the board at Power 9 Games after LVO.
Tim, did you have any fearsome opponents in the past that you feel you need to talk about?
I have. I actually kind of similar to what the others are saying. I've not had a chance to play a whole lot of Legion since the last time. So talking about a game that Ryan and I played a little while ago, where he had Han, Chewie, Leia, some fleets, pair of Wookiees, couple standard troopers in there, and then a sniper. I had Boba Veers, a couple flame frag snow troopers, 3 DLT storms, 2 bikes, and an E-Web.
It still amazes me that you can fit all that in 800 points.
Yeah, that's why I ran it, because I wanted to put. I was like, can I get 2 bikes and all these other cool things in there at the same list? The answer is yes.
The E-Web is only 55 points.
Yeah, I know. Don't remind me. My pizza gun is 70, and you guys get 55. Yeah,
I'm always preaching the E-Web gospel. So that's the first question: is will it fit? The second question is, will it work? And the answer to that is probably if someone good is playing it. For me, it's a no. For me, it's a solid no. We had, like I said, we had limited visibility. I believe we were playing key positions, and I started off really strong,
and I was able to move my flame troopers up because of the limit visibility. And so I was able to move them in without having to worry about the sniper, which was great. However, I was so focused on avoiding that sniper, I didn't realize that his fleets were where they were, and Ryan's stuff ended up coming in and really, really just destroyed a whole squad of flame troopers before they had a chance to do much of anything. Now, in contrast to this, my other squad of flame troopers, they were in cover probably too long, for maybe probably one turn too long. And so I think I had this weird dichotomy where this one squad's out in the open and they died real hard. And the other squad is hiding and saw their friends die, but they also didn't do anything about it until it was too late. They did a little something. They were able to whittle down some Wookiees, the Wookiee squad he had, and they whittled them down enough for Boba then to go in and finish the job, which was good. Although if this is where we talked about the medbot last time, we talked about how if it gives you one more Wookiee, maybe that makes a difference. If he had had one more Wookiee model, it would have made a difference because the Wookiees got to hit first, and I just was able to roll out of it. But one more Wookiee would have made a difference, possibly. So that said, the flame troopers did do a little bit, but not enough to really warrant it, and they ended up dying. Boba ended up dying next turn after he got those Wookiees. That was his last blaze of glory. The snipers, limit visibility lifted, as it does. They started raining some fire down. The bikes were amazing because they're bikes. And they went around the corner. They flew perfectly the way they should. I was actually pretty proud of that bike play, at least. It was good practice on that, if nothing else. And they were able to fly in. They were able to shoot Han a little bit, shoot Chewie a little bit. That flank was able to whittle down Chewie to where he wasn't really a threat. So that was good. But then the bikes were then shot by some backup troopers and the snipers, and I believe Leia came in. I don't think I ever touched Leia that game. And it was a good game. It was, but I just made some silly moves with those flame troopers that really cost me more than those troopers. It cost me a flank, and that's what it was.
By the end of it, I
forget what round we ended on, but by the end of it, it was just, there was no way for me to feasibly win it.
I think you play a bit of a scary list here, because I think snows and probably bikes are the really high impact things that you can bring into your list. But if you make a mistake with them, they're just dead. Both of them are such high risk, high reward, kind of like the Rebel fleet troopers. But bikes, I don't think the Rebels really have an equivalent to, with, like, if you just misstep them, they explode, especially with Han and Leia on the field, too, with Sharpshooter and Pierce, like, just don't care about all their tricks to stay alive. But yeah, that was a good game. I remember you shooting Chewie a lot when I wasn't sure why, but I know you hate Chewie, so.
Well, it wasn't so much that I hate Chewie, I hate Han, and so because I hate Han so much, Chewie suffered. I made Chewie suffer, and I made Han watch. It's fine. I have no problems. I only talk about it a little bit. It's okay. But Han saw his friend go down, and that's all that really counts in my book. It's fine.
Well, if you want to see pictures of all of our battles, take a look at our Instagram, where I post photos of our most recent events. I didn't post photos of Madman Rambler's defense dice. I took several screenshots, but I really wanted to post it. But for you guys, I didn't. But I try my best to keep that updated. New things that we're painting, new things we see on tables, any of the beautiful tables that we can put together, I love to post it up on the Instagrams. So check us out there.
If you want to go to check us out on there, you might as well look at all our other social media. You can find us on either Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, as Ben has said. You can rate us on iTunes, all these things. We are SW STABcast.
If you want to support the show in a more tangible way, you can head over to our t-shirt shop at teespring.com/stores/stabcast. Check out some merch for both us and our affiliates, the Sunsphere Defense Fleet, our X-Wing group. If you want to send us a line, send it to swstabcast@gmail.com. We'd love to do some Q&A. And the thing I've been asking for you guys to do, and you still haven't done it, is send me some pictures of your store. Send me infos about when and how you play. Let us be a platform to help connect gamers to you. LJ, where can people find you while we're talking about all this? Who are you? What do you do?
Well, I am located in a couple different places. You can, of course, find me as Talk Polite on the Star Wars Legion Discord, which maybe we can link a note in the show notes or something like that for people to find the link. But Yep, I'm on there running that baby in my spare time, and then also actually working on the Adepticon Legion page on Facebook, as well, of course, the LVO Legion Facebook page. So that's kind of, I think, the three best ways these days.
Yeah. Yeah, you can't go to many digital corners of the Legionscape and not find LJ somewhere. Just before the show, we were kind of making fun of him for spending too much time on the forums. So you can even find him there, the place we dare not go.
Hive of scum and villainy.
It is a scary place.
Well, speaking of a hive of scum and villainy, you should definitely check us out now on Google Play Music. I got the email yesterday that we are now officially uploaded there. So go say hello to the corporate overlords at the Google.
Yeah. Speaking of corporate overlords, we have gotten a ton of new news this week. As if the LVO and all like the meta analysis there wasn't enough, we've gotten 4 Legion articles between our last episode. So it'll probably be 6 by the time we edit this and get it out. But yeah, so we're going to talk about at least 4 of them. Tim, tell us about the Lizard Man, the Boogeyman.
Oh, Bosk. I don't know if that's a good Bosk accent, but it is today.
That's the best Bosk accent.
Like, not bad. I'm probably actually going to leave that.
Yep.
Thank you. I'm Bosk. Okay. I feel like there's not enough hype about him.
He's so good.
Do I think he's good as Boba? Yeah, he's not as good as Boba. No. Okay. But he brings so much versatility that as an Imperial player, I've been craving. He gives us so many options. And again, I don't think he's going to make or break a list. I don't think he's going to make... Well, he could make or break a game, just like anything would. But it's just the options he brings to you. I think he's solid to throw in there. I'm curious to see what else he can kind of do and, you know, see him in action. I mean, how can you really deny all those aims with that command card?
Ooh. It's so bad. That command card, I don't think is particularly strong. But
just put aim tokens though. If you got nothing else to run, it's a good one.
Yeah.
I don't know if we put it in the running with everything else, that's definitely something to talk about. I think he's really great at harassing things. He's a boba. He's a boba hunter. He's a bounty hunter. So that's what he does. You know, he's a harasser. Now, the other great thing is we run the possibility of maybe having a double bounty list. So if you run Boba Bosk, that's 2 victory points right there.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know if the rules, maybe this is on there. I've missed it. I don't know if you can put the bounty on the same person. No, I guess that wouldn't really benefit you. Never mind. I'm an idiot. Yeah. Don't listen to me. So you put it.
Cut this out.
I realize what I said.
No, I think putting them on the same person would be beneficial.
Yeah. No, I kind of like that because, you know, it's kind of bounty is a playful distraction when I play Boba, and I've been playing Boba quite a lot, you know, these last 5 months or so. But now you've, you know, practically guaranteed that, you know, maybe you can jetpack rocket followed by boss to pick off, you know, a bounty, I think.
Right. Doesn't it have to be that bounty hunter that kills them though?
They just have the bounty keyword. Your bounty tokens, unless they change this when boss drops, which they very well may, aren't tied. They can only be picked up by somebody with the bounty keyword. So if you put both of their bounties on the same target, as long as one of them kills them and lives to see the end of the game, that's 2 victory points.
Yep.
Okay. Then yes. Then I go back to what I was saying. Then yeah, let's put both bounties on one person. Absolutely. I think that's going to be really strong. And I think people aren't thinking about that. They're just thinking about his killing potential. Which is still strong anyway.
Which is still really strong.
But then you have that.
Yeah, I'm still waiting to see if you can get the 2 victory points for the 1 kill. But at the very least, I think you'll get the assurance that if you put both bounties on one person, you'll at least walk away with the 1 point. I think we have yet to see if you get 2 points.
Yeah.
But even if you do split them up, you can ignore the objective cards. At least play for the tie. Because key positions is only possibility of 3 points. And so if you get a double bounty, like as long as you have one of the points, you can at least put it to points destroyed. The only objective you don't want to see, and every double bounty player pulls it out of their deck, is intercept transmissions, where you can score up to 12. But even if you look at recover supplies, it's usually like a 2-3 or a 2-2 split. Sabotage is usually no more the high end of the scores. The most you can score is 4, typically. And breakthroughs scores tend not to be above four. So bounty could be a huge way to change the way that you play the game. I'm really excited to see what it adds.
Yeah, I'm excited to see him. He also, plus he's got the regenerative thing, which I think is awesome. I'm sure dice will betray you when you try and hope on that too much. I think it's going to be really cool. It will be interesting to see that and Enrage go back and forth to see how that plays out as far as
not only that, but regenerate and emergency stims interacting is going to be hilarious.
Lord, I hadn't even thought about that.
Bosca's angry. Bosca's angry. Bosca's really angry. No, he's not. Oh, yes. Yes, he is. No, he's not. It's going to be, I think it's going to be so much fun. But even more so, that makes it so interesting. You never know. And because of all the key word in all of those things, for the ones that have them, is the may. So that's going to give me the power. Like, do I want to do this? I don't know. Maybe I want boss to be angry. I probably do. Maybe I don't. And so that gives you so much power. I also like, on the side note, I like the endurance card. I think that's cool. I think it's going to bring a lot of options into for other things as well. I think it's just a neat little side note.
I don't know why. It's one of those cards, kind of like environmental gear, where like, I'm glad you're here. Why are you in that box?
Right.
I want you in a different box.
Awesome. Yes, I think it's going to be awesome for other things.
Is his melee attack better than Chewbacca?
He's got the Pierce.
The Pierce is pretty big.
He's got the Pierce.
Pierce is huge.
I mean, especially going Pierce against like, you know, Stormtroopers, where sometimes you just get punked by, you know, four blocks or whatever. Yeah, I want the Pierce.
Well, yeah, in my game with BG Moore, Chewie got a beautiful charge off. And he rolled five hits and five blocks came up. And I was like, okay, I'm just going to go be sad in the corner now. And it was a one-hit point Chewbacca. So it was like Chewie's last stand and he just gets punked. But yeah.
I honestly like the suppression game on him. 2-4 on an Imperial. Let's start suppressing the heck out of people again.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. I think, like I said, I think he brings a lot of versatility that we needed. And I think that's great. So I'm really excited for him. And I think it's a great point cost, too. I think it's a fair cost.
Do we know how much he is? Have we confirmed
that? You know, that's actually...
The picture's kind of blurry.
That's the big debate. I think we're unfortunately running into another Chewy situation where you've got about a 30-point gap that people are unsure if he's 85 or 115. And I don't think we have a for sure confirmation there.
Well, then.
Yeah, it'll be interesting. I think he needs to be triple digits, but maybe not. Maybe like right there at triple digits. I think if he's 85, he's way too cheap and I'm switching to Imperials.
No, that's fair. I think 85 is too cheap. Like, as much as I would love to have him, I think that is too cheap, to be fair.
I think it's going to be the Chewbacca thing. I think he's going to be higher than that, but
yeah,
I think he's 115 myself from my Googling enhanced vision. But
you know, what was hilarious was that, you know, we were all wondering still about the Chewy thing on the Discord. And then Luke randomly stepped in one day and was like, oh yeah, he's 110. And we were like, oh, okay, thanks, Lord and Savior. And then the same thing happened where people were debating like, oh, well, is he 85 or is he 115? And then Luke's like, he's somewhere between 85 and 115. So the troll was strong, and it was great. So he's whatever he ends up being. Just keep adding 30 points onto it.
Yeah, we'll probably figure it out. He'll be able to probably tell us once we get a little closer to release. But since it's still a ways off, we still got a tank and a speeder between now and then. So.
I mean, I think I'm going to take him at 115, and we don't know what his fancy new tokens or the rest of his command cards do yet.
Right, right.
So
now, you should never trust an FFG article, but he's clearly throwing some kind of Deoxys bomb.
Yeah.
Yep.
So I think it says in the article that's what he's throwing. I don't know. Perhaps it's just a can of shaving cream. But
someone's got to paint their – I mean, it's a dinosaur man. He's got to have the Jurassic Park – that's can exactly of shaving cream. Like, that's what he has to be throwing. Internet, make it happen.
Like, Nedry fought off Bosk in the back of that Jeep.
I want to see him look like the dad from Dinosaurs, that old TV show. That's what I want to see.
Lord.
Beautiful.
It'll be wonderful. I'm not good enough to do that, but internet, make it happen.
Let's walk away from the ugly dinosaurs. Let's talk about my lady Sabine. Oh, she is absolutely the operative that Luke Skywalker wanted. She's got Han's gunslinger. She's impervious with surging red defense dice and nimble. her 3-pip is basically kind of like Luke's. It gives her a reusable dodge token, and she can just hand it out to troopers. I think this is the first operative that we've seen that actually orders other people.
Chewie orders his friends around, but yeah.
I mean, it's that one-off. You can order two other guys with this one. I mean, yeah. What is she? She can throw bombs. She gets an inspire. I'm pretty sure she's got a personal shield. Again, that's using my CSI enhance abilities. But she's got that Mystery Sabine paint token. I guess you just get to repaint a model in the middle of a game. And she's got the Darksaber. I think the Darksaber is really, really good. Ryan's initial feedback in the text, we're in our little text pod here. Ryan's like, she's kind of Boba light. She's not that great, but I think he's undervaluing her, just like he did with Chewie. Because now he loves Chewie, but I think he's undervaluing her pretty hard.
Maybe so. Do you take the Darksaber? Is it an auto include?
I think it is, in part to ignore that Pierce, because Tim hates Pierce.
But it's just melee.
Is it just melee?
It's just melee. It's just melee, Pierce.
I wonder. It also gives her a much better personal combat weapon. I mean, it gives her impact one and pierce one. So,
sure. We'll have to, for me, it comes down to what her other two command cards are. Because if you get engaged, if you're in melee and there is a melee pierce weapon, she probably won't get to use impervious and immune to pierce at the same time. And I feel like the Darksaber is a 25-point trap that turns off some of her keywords. It's going to be great that she's fast, but unless some of her command cards give her charge, I don't, you're trading away Gunslinger. Gunslinger is really good.
Oh, no. I think Dauntless is in case you need to. Gunslinger is when you want to avoid it. I think she's also speed 3. I mean, I think she can evade a melee if she really wants to. I think it's when you need to go in up and personal for the kill.
But it's black again, dice, it's 25 good. Points. And I'm the point pincher, so I don't even take Z6s. So 25 points is a lot of points.
And LVO says you're wrong about that.
Yes, they do.
When we're talking about last podcast, we talked about Vader making a comeback. Mm-hmm. If you're talking about Vader making a comeback and you don't run her, you're going to run into problems. But if you run her with that Darksaber, then that's going to help counter Vader.
That's if Vader makes the comeback, which with Bossk coming now, who knows if he is anymore. We're going to take this cheaper melee Vader and guy Bossk instead. Work
together. We saw it in the movies. Vader and Bossk work together, all I'm saying.
I was actually thinking of a great list to run and started to put it through Tabletop Admiral, and be darned if someone on the Legion Facebook page didn't do it for me. But a fully loaded Luke, Sabine, 5 Rebel Zs, and 3 Snipers, that's a solid, I think, 795.
Yeah.
Yeah, it fits. Solid. That's a ton
of damage
from
a range, and ton of damage up close. You're going to wipe out any troopers, and if all the objectives still require troopers, I'm just saying.
Which they probably will, yeah. But the third news article we got, and probably the one that I'm the most excited for, is we got to see the rest of Jyn's kit. Jyn Erso, the next commander for the Rebellion. Oh my goodness. It's so good. It's so strong. The flip side of her pistol card is probably the least exciting thing. It's basically downgrades her 2 red dice to black dice, gives her an extra range, but keeps the pierce keyword. I'm not sold on it, but I've been playing Han a lot. I play a lot of Fleet Troopers, so range 2 isn't that hard to achieve. I think you just leave it in pistol mode to get that extra red dice. I could be wrong on that. Red, red, white with pierce 1 sounds really, really good. It sounds a lot better than black, black, white at range 3.
I'm with you. I think range 2 isn't as hard to maintain as some people like to think it is. I'm with you on that. I think I take the extra dice and just try to stay at range 2.
Especially because she has a darn good melee weapon. And that's where Han's drawback is, where range 2 is a problem, is you got to get close to stuff. But with her having a better melee attack that's suppressive that Han doesn't, I think that can be really, really strong. But man, the two things that they showed us are those command cards. Oh my goodness. They're so good. We had her first command card they showed us a while back that gave her charge, which is neat and that's cool. But her 2-pip, I think this 2-pip needs to be the template for what all 2-pip cards need to feel like. It's not so staggeringly strong like Son of Skywalker or Now You Die or Implacable, but it's not kind of a waste like Somebody Has to Save Our Skins, because that's probably arguably the least impactful 3 pip in the game. But it is, it's for that turn. It's for the, it fits the role in the pace of the game where you're not sure what your opponent's going to do. So you throw your 2 pip. If they go for their utility 3 pip card, you get to go first, but it even helps keep you a little bit safe if they throw their 1 pip. So if you're not sure, this 2 pip giving Inspire 2 and Teamwork with Jyn Erso to whoever else she orders, that's absolutely incredible. It's, I don't know, the only drawback of it is you kind of have to activate Jyn first, because the unit that she orders gains Teamwork Jyn Erso, and I imagine they lose that keyword after their activation, after their order token goes face down. So if you want to give the token both ways twice, you have to activate Jyn first, which with Inspire 2, you probably want to have Jyn go later in the round, but that's up to debate. And it's going to be a really fun situational card that bails you out. But then you get Complete the Mission, her 3 pip card. Is this going to be the new best card in the game? Best command card?
We just got back from the best 3 pip cards from the last
game. I know. Is this the new one, though? Am I wrong?
I think it depends on what kind of player you are. I think if you're a flashy, burst damage kind of person, you're still going to keep a special place in your heart for, Son of Skywalker, and Now You Will Die and stuff like that. But if you're, and I think I know this is why you love it so much, Ryan, you are an objective-focused guy, which I've played against you and watched you play, you are laser-focused on objective more than most people I see. It's going to be something you keep in your back pocket to make sure that turn 5 or 6 goes your way.
Yeah. Yep. I think this is the strongest turn 5 card in the game. Guarantees you 6 actions on 3 troopers. And the funny thing is with her high bravery, it's not her. I think you let other people, you let your fleet troopers, you let your generic stock rebel troopers, your 1 bravery units get 6 guaranteed activations to get on those boxes, to take those dodge tokens, whatever they need to do to stay alive, to get you to the end of the game. That is huge. It basically, the card, for those of you that haven't seen, it's got a whole bunch of text, gives Jyn low profile, so she's going to stay alive, and then orders 3 troopers that you can give suppression tokens to. And remember, her and the Pathfinders get more defense dice the more suppressed that they are. And then during their activation, if you have a face-up order token, you cannot be suppressed and you cannot be panicked. And then you remove 1 suppression token after your turn. Getting 6 guaranteed actions is going to be absolutely huge. Because how many times have your games come down to turn 5, turn 6, a clutch rally roll? If you can remove that need for that clutch rally roll, that's insanity. Absolute insanity. I love it. Absolutely love it.
I think you can use it on Jyn, especially if you've had to abuse danger sense the turn before. Like, things were looking bad. You just keep those suppression tokens. Because you and I have both shot at the same unit repeatedly, and Han Solo hasn't died. He's got 19 suppression on him, but Magic Cloak means he hasn't died yet. And so I can see you use it on Han and her just to make sure they get all the actions. Because if Han can only shoot twice but can't move to get in the range, he's so limited.
Yeah, that's true. Suppressed. That's fair. What are your guys' impression of these, I guess, these 3 cards, the gun and then the 2 command cards that are both bonkers?
Hater. I hate it. Hater.
All right.
She's awful.
Do you hate it? Do you hate it because it's strong? Like, does this, if you're only going to see this from the other side of the table because you don't get to play it.
Correct.
Does this not, going to give you some fun counterplay? Because I actually really like playing against Palpatine. Not because I think he's bad. I think he's a really strong piece. But for me, he's really fun to mind game against. Does this not scream like fun counterplay to you, Tim?
Do you know who I am? Do you know how I play this game? Do you think this sounds fun to me? This sounds like so much anger. So much hatred. I'm going to be so mad at myself when I screw this up. It's just going to be awful.
I think what is interesting is that you have to refresh to reconfigure. And so you're taking an action away where with the Imperial side and their reconfigure things, you can do that with Veers.
Yeah, with Imperial Discipline. Yep.
With Imperial Discipline. And so that kind of gives you that free action to reconfigure your weapon to what you need to. I like the mechanic. It's a little bit more limited on the rebel side because you want to use those actions to, you know, to get in and punch someone with a baton.
Yeah, I honestly thought, you know, when we first saw the reconfigure keyword and we only saw one of Jin's command cards, I thought at least one of her two cards, if not both of them, would let you refresh units. And I'm kind of surprised we didn't get that. For her being the one and the troopers she comes with being the ones to introduce that mechanic, that we don't have a really accessible way to do it. But it's probably, you know, like, heaven forbid this game is like competitive and balanced. So,
you know, what's a good refresh thing for her, though? A good way to refresh all of them? The test firing of a super weapon.
Board state.
But you know what we did? We completed the mission, though, and we had all our actions while we did it.
You completed a terrorist action, and you shall be punished.
That scene just represents how awesome Legion is, because you can totally get wiped out, still win the day.
Yeah. Yep.
That's so true.
That's so true.
That is true.
Vader can be mercilessly slaughtering your fleet troopers, but you know what? You intercepted that damn transmission.
That's right.
That's right. That's right.
You know, the crazy thing we really haven't talked about is the sculpts on Sabine and Bosk. The fact that you're getting multiple poses in the same box.
Yeah,
it's fantastic.
That's super cool. And I will say, like, this restored a bit of my faith in FFG. I was a little shaken, and I don't think we talked about it on the show, but when we talked about the tank and when we talked about the speeder, they're pretty expensive units just in USD, in US dollar bills. So when I heard that we're getting multiple sculpts for Bosk and Sabine, I was like, oh, great. Now my commanders, instead of being, you know, $12 at Sci-Fi City, they're going to be 25, and their price is the same. So good on you, FFG. Appreciate it.
Absolutely. The Australian people do thank you for that, at least, because everything costs four times as much in Australia.
This is true.
You poor people.
Yeah, no, I'm pretty thrilled for the multi, you know, part kits. Those are going to be awesome. And I like magnets, so I'll be able to use everything.
I was about to say, like, I just praise them for being cheaper, but basically that means we're all going to have to buy two of each of them so we can have one in each pose. I don't have time for those magnets. They have mold lines and stuff. Can't have that. Can't have that. Except my units look like garbage anyway, so I can.
I don't even know how to drill in with a magnet, so it's just going to be two arm magnets that look like Lego figures. It's like, bonk, bonk. So the other piece of news that we got was the ATST down, the beautiful piece of terrain for $50 and some battle cards that are very exclusive to that particular set. LJ, we talked about this before the show. What are you thinking about the ATST down?
I mean, I'm a fan. I don't think I'm going to immediately spring to buy it, but, you know, I, as somebody who runs all these events, I think they're trying to cater to the, you know, narrative side of the community that likes to play, you know, at home with their core group of people over beer and pretzels. And there's nothing wrong with that. Right. We get so many releases in this game. How could you possibly complain about them putting out more stuff, you know? And it doesn't detract from the game at all. And even worse, if they would have put actual game components for the competitive part of the game in there, more battle cards, I think you would have seen a public uproar over putting it behind a $50 paywall as opposed to priority supplies, which was, you know, in the 20s, right?
So, but I'm a former X-Wing player. I paid the Palpatine tax. I paid the C-3PO tax.
I am not, and I am happy those taxes do not exist in this game, my friend.
Yeah.
No, I don't mind. I like it. We're getting more content, guys. There's nothing wrong with this, you know? That's my outlook.
My only hope is that it doesn't claim one of our monthly release slots. Like, I hope this is like an added benefit instead of like, here you go, for 2 months this is what you get. You get a crashed ATST to play your narrative games with. And I'm glad the narrative community is getting something. I really am, because they deserve
it. Yeah, I'm actually kind of hoping that this kit might be part of the drawdown to Clone Wars. And it'll be like, we'll get Sabine, Bosk right after we get the tanks, and then right after the two new operatives, this comes in, and then after that, it's just all Clone Wars quotes, all prequel memes. That's it.
No,
nothing will hurt. No. It'll be all prequel memes.
Now, I will say I do love the sculpt of this. I absolutely do.
Yes.
And I actually like the objective scenario games that FFG puts together. It's not the way that Ryan and I play here locally. We're too competitive, try hard for that. But I actually really like the objectives. And Ryan and I have talked about trying to find time to do some TTS games where we walk people through the objectives and or the scenarios, and we play them out. And we have a hard time recording the show on time. Never mind playing extra games on that and stream them. But we're trying. That's right. But I do like the scenarios. I've always liked the deployments in there. I like the narrative piece. It feels like Imperial Assault, a game that we used to play. I mean, I do like it.
Did you guys catch what point range the scenario was at?
No.
Is it for a standard 800-point game? Because, you know, that's the other thing. If it is, at least, you know, it's a standard 800-point game, unlike the operations, which have all been escalation-type things, you know?
Right. Yeah, it'll be interesting. My guess is it probably is, because if you're buying a $50 piece of terrain, you're probably invested enough to at least have 800 points. But my biggest thing about ATST Down is it means I was right. We talked about our conspiracy theories about what this missing product was, and we were just kind of BSing, taking shots in the dark, and I made a crack about how it's clearly the deluxe barricade pack. And I think I'm pretty close.
It really is.
All right, nothing more deluxe than a downed ATST, baby. That's it.
Like, all the memes and jokes aside.
Yeah, look at the way it's laying down. That's deluxe. That is luxury.
Oh, yeah. God bless you, internet. Let me draw you like my French ladies. That meme. Oh, it's great. Yeah. And I will say, Ryan, are you going to house rule it so that you can jump over that ATST?
All right, we're not talking about this right now, all right? Go back and listen to our Gen Con episode. And
too soon, Ben. Too soon.
Too soon. August wasn't that far along. Fargo.
It was 6 months ago.
I know.
Too soon.
But I haven't gotten another game with Nick Freeman since then, so.
Well, speaking of Nick Freeman, a man who's notorious for taking a great bid, here's a segment I'm calling Red Player's Dilemma. You took 800 points against Nick, so you're playing the denial game. Make sure you deny him any advantage in any of the setup, which means you get a list or setup that looks something like this. Limited visibility, major offensive, recover supplies. How do you plan for that?
I think this is neat. I think limited visibility is one of the most throw a wrench in the works cards in the game, especially for a set of cards, but just cards in general, really. And I think you use it to your advantage, especially as red player. You're trying to do that denial stuff, using major offensive to your advantage, and trying to use that in such a way that you can maybe dodge with all these snipers running around, using it to get into cover early against snipers, or using those two together to get it to where snipers won't make a difference, or at least minimize their impact, if at all possible. Reminds me a little bit of Ryan and I's game that I talked about before, where using that limited visibility, I was able to move those flame troopers up untouched by the snipers, at least. Now, again, word of warning, don't forget about the other units in the list. But I think that's a really cool possibility to use that, and I love limited visibility again with all these snipers running around. I think I throw it down just about every time, unless I'm trying to run an ATSD or something like that where I want to have range 4. I know the DLTs like range 4, but to me it's worth it to stay safe longer, and then I'll just use my DLTs later. But I think it's really cool, and again, using those two things together to play into recover the supplies. Ben, what do you think?
I'm with you on this. With limited visibility, it means you're probably able to pick up your two boxes very, very early. So no matter what list I'm playing, if it's Imperial or Rebel, I put my boxes as close to me as possible. I try to make it so one unit or two can pick them up. And then I call them my garbage men, and their entire job is to get out of line of sight before Leia shows up, before Veer shows up, before snipers show up. Their job is just going to hide. And then everyone else is going to go dogpile on the center. It's going to be a bloodbath. It's going to be gross. But I think the fight over that third box is where you have to. But I think it goes back to early in the episode, though. If there's bounties floating around, maybe you kind of have to protect those guys, because bounties in this game is going to throw some things. I mean, but I think you focus everything in the middle. You try to keep those boxes behind a tree, behind some down tank, someplace where they won't get shot at. And just pray for the final round or time or destroy the opponent real hard.
So the combo of these cards is really interesting. Major offensive puts you so close, at least in portions of the map, to your opponent, that honestly, limited visibility for probably a quarter of the map is a non-factor. And it forces, if you want to play that shooty, shooty, bang fighting game, it forces everything in the middle, kind of like what Ben was talking about, where everybody's kind of deploying into that upper corner of the box that you get that points towards the center of the board. But I think the way that I personally, and with my play style, set this up is I spread out my two boxes as far as I can. And I really try to use that limited visibility to my advantage and pressure the place where my opponent, unless he stacked them towards the middle, placed his two boxes to get the most out of that limited viz. I really feel like this particular setup of these three cards is going to make the center and the edges of the map feel like two very, very, very different games. And it's going to be the trick between you and your opponent trying to manage the tempo of your list, trying to manage bag control, trying to manage your activations to see who can manage that tempo a bit better to get the edge, to get the advantage before the curtain, as you will, lifts of limited visibility.
The curtain of fog.
Yeah, because it's either going to be a zero factor if you deploy in the middle, or a huge factor if you deploy out on the wings, because at the edges of major offensive, you have a lot of real estate that it's very difficult for your opponent to get to. And if you see your opponent stacking everything in the middle, you stack everything on the sides and you kind of envelop them. And yeah, you say you're going to get the middle box, but I'm going to pick off anything that comes out to the edges to try to contest some of those other boxes. This is, I think, is a really interesting setup that can create, you can play a bunch of different ways to fit your play style on how you want to play the game.
I want to make a Hannibal Rome versus Carthage joke right here.
Yeah. Yep, you do. Yep. Old classic war game. There's like three people who will get it. It's great. But the reason that we've brought LJ here to talk so polite to us is he got to be the tournament organizer and leader and social media guru. Like, all the prep you were putting into this event was like staggering for something that we've seen for a game that's only a year old. So we brought you to kind of break down the LVO for us from our different perspectives. So first, give us for somebody who's been under a rock, what is the LVO? What was it, I should say?
All right, so the Las Vegas Open is a wargaming convention in, of course, Las Vegas, Nevada, at a place called Bally's Casino, if you've never been. And so they run many, many, many different war games, the biggest, of course, being, you know, Warhammer 40K. And that's actually one of the, I think, the last ITC events of the year. Mm. But it's a pretty prestigious event. And you've got 3 days of gaming, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and people play all sorts of stuff. So this was, of course, the first year that Legion got to be at the event. And I think when I took over in August, they had about 15 or so people registered. And then like the week after I took over, and this had nothing to do with me being involved, we turned into a maximum firepower event. And I don't know how they squeaked that in, but it got changed. And then suddenly, you know, things got a little more serious. So I started to kind of get the community prepped and get the word out there that, hey, this was going to kind of be a, you know, an event that I think it would be worth it for you to go to. And the community kind of put their faith back in me, and we reached very quickly 50 players. And then I expanded again, and we had a total of 64, you know, fully registered. And I believe the wait list was somewhere in the mid-40s. So in total, we attracted around 100 people to get interested in the event. And, you know, we had 62 out of 64 on the day. So pretty good.
That's great. Yep. That's actually Gen Con, and it was 3 32-man events, and they were sold out within the first day of registration for Gen Con. We had about 20 people show up. So we had, you know, 12 to 15 people each day not show up. So the fact that you had only two missing is incredible.
Yeah. So I think the final total was somewhere around, you know, 4. And then we had a couple waitlist guys show up. And it was funny because we actually had a couple guys that were on the waitlist show up. But because they didn't think there'd be space, they unfortunately did not bring their armies. So they we could have had the full 64, but the opportunity unfortunately missed there. But yeah, still pretty great. We actually only had one player drop after lunch, and then he actually stayed and hung out. He just stopped playing because he was bushed. And so the 2% attrition rate is also pretty much unheard of, as you had talked about. The other tournaments, but just from, any convention tournament, that was pretty awesome.
I think because of your success with this tournament, I think that's why Adepticon sold out so fast. I mean, it was within hours. The entire thing was gone.
Oh, yeah. So 2.5 hours. Yeah.
Kudos on that.
Well, thanks. You know, I'd really been pushing the social media aspect of it hard. And, people ask me, like, why did you make the decisions you make? And I just want to step back and remind the community that, like, I'm a player. I'm here to play Star Wars Legion, and I've been here to play Star Wars Legion since I finally, was able to start playing it in August, in person. And from that point on, I know what the big tournaments look like, and I know what our big tournaments had, up to this point been lacking. And so I just sat down, with my marshal and was like, how do we make these things happen? So I started putting up pictures of the tables. And of course, that got people really interested because they're like, holy crap, your event's going to have real tables with 25% terrain. What a weird concept. And, then I started putting up prizes because people got more interested in our event and started supporting us. And so it's just like those two bastions of success, the prize support and the tables, kind of like bounced off each other, and one would get better, so the other one would get better. And it just kind of kept, like, in my opinion, going back and forth between the two. And I think it helped keep the community, greatly involved. And it truly was a community effort. There were so many businesses and podcasts and blogs and individuals that got interested through this event. And, I don't like to put myself out in front when it comes to the success. I really, really, really do like to point at, the community and say, this is you guys, and if this game is going to continue on into year 2, 3, 4, 5, it's going to be because you guys are going to continue to do so much for us.
One of the segments we do a lot on this show is talking about how to organize your community, and I think that's, you can't have a better pitch than what you just said about it. It is one guy who seems to be the front of it, it's because you put a relationship with 40 other people who help you put the thing together and then run it. And then the players who come out and supported you for that, that's what it takes to build a good community. I had a whole bunch of questions here, but LJ basically just answered just about everything here. So I have to ask you. So how'd you get your admin team together? I mean, it took six of you to do this. It looks like you stole one from FFG. I think you cheated one in by marrying her. And then where'd the other three guys come from?
Oh, man. So... yeah, it really was kind of a small team up until the event, and then things kind of started to get more serious when I realized, logistically, I was going to need more hands. So, I kind of started working on it by myself, but very quickly at the start, I got in contact with a guy called Brendan Franz, and Brendan is a major player in the Arizona scene, which is actually a fairly sizable group. Now that I've met them and interacted with them, they just hadn't really started to travel yet. And so with his support, I think 17 of the tables came from him and his local scene. I mean, that's a contribution in itself, right? But he just messaged me through, I think he might have contacted me through Nick, actually, now that I think about it. But he messaged me. It was like, hey, I want to help. And, I think I could help you out with your event. And I, asked him a couple questions, and, we hit it off pretty well, pretty quickly. So, Brendan was there from the start, kind of helping me manage the terrain piece. And a lot of that, if you think that part looked good, then you can thank him, because he did a lot of the groundwork there. And then I started to kind of get more people involved as time went on. It's Vegas, and it was the week before Valentine's Day. So it was actually fairly easy to convince my wife, hey, you want to go to Vegas again? Sure. Okay, cool. And but I mean, she was a trooper. I mean, she was, first of all, she was in her Endor Leia costume, which is awesome. It's Vegas. Awesome. So the fact that a couple of my staff, dressed up was amazing. And she was taking pictures. She probably took 500-600 pictures of that day. Just all the tables, the detail pictures of people playing. That was, I mean, honestly, that was awesome. That's not something I could have done running the event. Dave from Imperial Terrain brought 10 tables, and he drove up from Texas with his 10 tables, and he just helped. You know, it was like, hey, I need to get my trophies from Frontline Gaming. And Dave's like, all right, cool, I'll help out. Or, you know, I need this weird, odd job to be done. And Dave, you know, was willing to help. So that was actually pretty fantastic. You had Kyle or Orchimedes from Never Tell Me the Odds. He was our judge that helped Brendan out with all those judge calls. And I think I had mentioned it before, but he came from Virginia just to help us out. I mean, he didn't play. He just flew over. He already had his qualifier spot and just wanted to give us a hand. So, you know, big shout out to him for doing that. And then, of course, the last person was Luke Getty. And so, you know, Luke didn't have a big hand in running the tournament itself, but it was so nice to, you know, to have him come up and just be there, you know, say hi to the community, do a couple meet and greets, you know, jump on a couple podcasts and just talk to people and just show, you know, the players like, yeah, this event wasn't run by FFG, but we're here to support the community. And again, I think it just really, really nicely rounded out that whole, hey, this is a community effort thing that I was talking about.
One of the nice things about Gen Con was the ability to just sit back and talk to those people. Talk to Luke. What are you thinking about this? Where are we going with that? I love this thing. Oh, I don't like that thing. To give the feedback, and he took it all very seriously. He was a great guy to have a conversation with. I mean, it's great that he was able to make it out. I've got to be honest. I mean, no shade to Adepticon, because I attended. That was the launch event. I went to Gen Con. I saw beautiful pictures of the Grand River Open. My sister lives up there. Our local store, I think Ryan and I put on some really nice things. I mean, and the Discord tournaments are fantastic. I've thoroughly enjoyed that. But LJ, I think you really do deserve a New Hope style medal ceremony, or, you know, so at least a Yub Nub Ewok celebration, something in your honor, because you managed to spearhead, I think probably it's going to be the hard press to top with the upcoming Adepticon.
You know, if we weren't so dead tired at the start of the top cut at round five, I probably would have played the ceremony music, whether New Hope or, you know, Ewok celebration. But I was super tempted to play that music at the start of the awards ceremony, because I know those guys, you know, they deserved it for going the distance in the five rounds there at the end. But as Ryan had kind of just started to mention, I'm not TOing and I'm not judging Adepticon. But I actually did spend about, you know, because I hate myself and don't know when to say no, I spent about an hour on the drive home with one of the guys that is the lead at Adepticon. And he talked about, you know, me kind of advising their process, because, you know, nobody had really taken the reins over there. And, you know, they kind of wanted some direction. And the guy in charge is super enthusiastic. He is great. And trust me, no shade at them, because they've got so much other stuff going on, and we're a first year game. I mean, you know, people got to keep that in mind. Legion's not even a year old yet, and Adepticon will kind of signal that first birthday. So, like, I'm not surprised that they still had some work to do, and I am more than happy to help, because as I had said earlier, I'm a player and I want it to be a successful event. So I do have some exciting announcements connected to Adepticon. I spent the last 24 hours working on their last chance qualifier and their high command packet. So those are out and those are now in the wild. So if you're looking for information on those, they're on the Adepticon website. There's an Adepticon Facebook page for Legion that you should also follow as well. And, you know, those packets are out. The team packet should be out by the end of the week for those details. Depending on who wins Adepticon or who has the majority wins, I guess, there actually is going to be implications in Star Wars Legion from a swag and card standpoint. I know that was an early on promise, but I do believe that is still going to happen, depending on who gets the top spot at high command. And we actually have made a very serious push for streaming in the last couple of days as well. And so I believe, and I don't want to say too much just because I want these guys to get their ducks in line first, but streaming will have a presence at Adepticon as well. And I think that was one of the biggest comments I got at LVO, was that people really wanted table streamed. And it was some like crazy, ridiculous, like $2,000 price to get ourselves an internet line and stream some games. But Adepticon is not in that boat.
Yeah.
And I believe we will have like basically a couple streaming tables, quote unquote, set up, so that, you know, we can have matchups that we think are interesting, or people that just happen to land on that table will have their matches streamed. Right. And then high command, we can have the top couple tables streamed by people that have been either podcasting or Twitch casting, because as you guys know, we've built up a pretty good community on Twitch. So super excited.
I do have some questions as someone who is the junior member of the podcast, and especially someone who is newer to the big gaming scene. Gen Con was my first foray into like a big miniatures gaming event. And so maybe coming at it from that angle of someone who's not familiar with that and the ins and outs of all that, just a couple questions of if you're new to that and you're going into these things for the first time, what's maybe just a couple key tips to help someone get into that? Because again, thinking of Gen Con, it was an amazing experience. I instantly got ready to go again next year or this year now. And so it was really impressive, but it was also a little overwhelming. So is this just anything you would advise for that?
I think the best thing you can do is, first of all, go to tournaments, because tournaments should have some sort of timer and you can start practicing with that time crunch. Sure. That's a big one. I tell people, go to tournaments before you go to a big tournament, because the pace is going to catch you off guard. The second thing that also kind of helps you with the first thing is just know your own stuff. Make sure you're packed light. So in my Adepticon box, I've got all the components I need for the army and nothing else. The only thing I took double of is I took two sets of command tokens. So for some reason, well, I guess that probably won't happen anymore because I'm kind of in charge now. But if they said, hey, we are not going to use your LVO tokens, then, you know, you have to use the standard component. You're not SOL. So if you have something, let me backtrack a little. If you have something that is custom, maybe have a backup for that. So like if you're Luke super converted, maybe have the core set Luke with you as well. But, you know, just have your stuff be light. And know your stuff, because then you won't be the guy that's searching through your own stuff to find, you know, suppression tokens or something like that. So have your kit strapped down and light. That'll help you be, you know, be kind of in command of your own situation, because you can only really ever control your stuff, right? You can't control what the other person brings to the table. But if you're, you know, succinct and to the point and prepared, it'll make your half of the deal a lot easier, I think. The other important thing is drink water. Seriously. There was one person at LVO that literally fainted. Yes. Not in Legion, but on the big floor. There was one guy that fainted, and he actually got back up and finished his game, mind you. That's true. That's a true story.
Awesome.
But they had to, you know, slap him or put the salt under his nose and get him back into the game. But that's the other thing, too, is, like, people forget, but, you know, I hate myself for saying it, but hydrate or dihydrate, because, you know, you don't want to be that guy that's, you know, sucking at the end of round four and you're 3-0 and it's the difference between you making it and you, you know, losing a game.
Trust me, I've learned from Gen Con that come next Gen Con, I will be there in force and in fanny pack force. My fanny pack will be loaded to the brim with refreshments. No shame.
So go find Tim at Gen Con if you need refreshments.
Check.
All right, so we've talked about the new player. We've talked about TOs. Let's talk about the list. Let's talk about what you saw, because we didn't get to go. It was a little too far for me to justify. What was the big picture question? We had 62 players. What was the Rebel Imperial ratio? That's the question I probably see most frequently on the Facebook groups and Discord and the forums.
If I'm remembering correctly, the ratio was 34 Imperial to 32, to 28 Rebel, I think it was.
Okay.
So
that sounds about average.
It was like a 55-45 split was like kind of like the percentage number. Right. So that was great. It was great to see the diversity be so close. And then I believe the top cut was actually 7 Rebel, 5 Imperial. So if you want to put like a percentage on it, the Rebels did technically do better when it came to making the finals. And then, as I think, some people have already noticed, the winners that went the distance were half and half, 3 Rebels, 3 Imperial.
That's awesome.
That's great.
So guys, quit balance whining. Stop it. we have a really fun balanced game. I'm tired of seeing it on the internet. The other thing, you know, looking at the Never Tell Me the Odds blog at swlegionodds.com, he got to post the 6 invitees list. And I'm sure we'll get a really good breakdown of all of the lists in the coming days, probably by the time this podcast goes live. The thing that kind of struck me about the top 6 lists, all of these bids are really small bids. You know, we talked about on our show about how a 5-point bid is about where you should look for if you care about blue player at all. And 5 points is the most aggressive bid in this top cut. Was that true for most of the day, or what do you attribute to that?
Like, I think so.
That took me as super interesting.
Yeah, I'd say so. I saw very little bids across the board. I think that, you know, the players have kind of circled around on some of the key, key issues that plagued the game and really drove the bids. And so I think things equalize like they should. I think the KP thing proved that the devs are listening and will fix problems in a timely manner if they are seen as legitimate problems. It was funny because one of the two things we gave, and this was actually sponsored by ImpactX, was we gave new rapid reinforcement and key position cards, reprinted ones, to the people that came to LVO. And, you know, people commented, and that was a chatting point, was that, you know, I think, yes, now that that's been fixed, there's not a huge reason to worry too much about the bid. And, you know, I think part of it, too, was people saw the tables. They saw the tables through the Facebook page, and they realized that, you know, they're not necessarily going to be like StarCraft-style tables where both sides of the board are the same.
Right.
But that you knew you were probably getting a fair shake even if you didn't get to choose your side.
Sure. And I guess to that point, did you, in your preparation, did you have your tables pre-built, or did you just kind of have a bin of stuff and you're like, this is a table, or did you already go through and map out, well, this bunker's going here, this piece of area terrain is going to go here, or was it just kind of a throw things together on the day of or the day before?
A little bit of column A, a little bit of column B. I think Dave's
fair.
Tables, he set them all out very nicely in the studio and sent us pictures, so I know he had ideas in mind for those tables. And then a lot of Brendan's tables have actually been tried and tested in his local tournaments. So, yeah, that's so awesome. They had setups that they knew were definitely going to work, and then I'd say the rest of that equation was, you know, Brendan putting everything on the table, sitting down with Kyle and saying, yeah, I think this looks good, or no, let's chuck something from the box of scatter on here.
Right. That's actually, like, that's one of my favorite things to do before a tournament. We used to set up our events on Friday night, me and Ben would throw crap on a table, and then I would get range measurement tools out and kind of scoot stuff around, and it was a good way to burn a Friday night.
Let's make sure that box is directly on the center, but not just slightly on the left-hand side of this wall. Like, yeah, doing that kind of rearrangement. We need a little bit of scatter here, toss some stuff out. Yeah, love that part of that.
And, you know, one of the other things, too, I think that helped is that, you know, LVO was the testbed for the barricade rule. And, you know, the way the barricade rule worked is before blue player is chosen, you and your opponent look at the table and say, hey, do we need to address any problems here? And, you know, that was a collaborative process that, honestly, we didn't really see any problems on. It didn't cause any fights. The players didn't have to decide, oh, well, you know, I'm going to place this here and screw you. Like, it was highly collaborative. It made me feel really good about the community we have here, to be perfectly honest. And, you know, and, and I thought that went very well to kind of easing some of the players' terrain concerns. So, and it helped fix any perceived gaps that we had in the tables, because, you know, we're setting up 32 tables. Sometimes we miss things.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, another glaring thing I saw, once again, I'm not the big Luke fanboy. I really love Han. I love Han Laelis. There's no Han in the top six. What's going on here? And why are there pizza guns? Where's Han and why is there pizza?
Well, three of them are Imperial, Ryan. They can't legally take them.
Well, if all you right, look well. At one of the lists, there's actually a stormtrooper with a very familiar-looking face riding around in there. I'm sure Han could have made it in the list if you really want to. That would have been my choice for Imperial officer. Make a Han and Luke model and use them as my Imperial officers. Oh, so good. You got to do something with those extra models. But anyway. No, I don't know what the overall list variety looked like yet, just because I gave all of my report slips and my army list to Orc to go do his breakdown. So it's highly possible we're going to see. I think Khan did make it into the top 12 twice. I know of at least one person off the top of my head that had him. But Luke is just, he's just Luke. I mean, he's just, I think that's what the top six teaches me, is it just shows me what in this game is very efficient. And, you know, you're not throwing the, what I'd call the jank game at people with, you know, with Luke. Han, you've got tricks up your sleeve and you can mess with your opponent's game plan. But at the end of the day, you know, I think efficient is safer than jank. And that's kind of what I see in these top six. It's not saying that, look, none of the other models in the game are worthy because they didn't make it. I just think, you know, that's what the players put their faith in and it rewarded them, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, no, that totally makes sense. Other on the other side of the table, the glaring omission of the top six we have is Vader, but I think we kind of all expected that because Vader doesn't tend to be efficient, especially over six. What, these guys had to play five games?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the four rounds puts in the top cut.
Yeah, getting Vader to be consistent for five games is rather tricky. But we did have an Emperor list, and we did have two Boba and Veers lists. So were there any surprises, list building wise, things you didn't expect to see that popped up?
How many T-47s?
There was two T-47s the whole day? Maybe three? Sorry, guys.
Great. Love you guys.
Yeah, sorry. They really didn't make it. There was actually, I was surprised how many AT-STs I saw. There was one map I saw that had three AT-STs, two on one side and one on the other. So that was the scrap heap that I, as an Imperial player, was reveling to see. But
awesome.
I think what people are pointing out already is that they're very surprised to see two of the FDs make it into the top six.
Yeah. I have not found a way to make it work.
Yeah. Oh, Kingsley. Kingsley's a great player. He plays very fundamental. I hate to make this analogy, but he's the women's basketball of Legion. Great fundamentals. Not too flashy, but Kingsley gets the job done every time.
Mm-hmm. Now, remember, you're speaking to the home of Pat Summit. You know, the ladies volunteers. We take our ladies basketball very serious here.
Yep, true. And you know, true. I went to Gonzaga University, which has a very proud women's team, and we host one of the tournament rounds every year. So I feel you. But
do you know where the WNBA Hall of Fame is? It's in Knoxville.
Yep. But yeah, no, I was very happy to see the FD hit the table, and you know, maybe distill some of the, you know, the craziness around it. They both players, I believe, just took it naked. You know, the base FD is good enough FD. And I think part of that is because they felt comfortable with the tables, knowing that they could probably deploy it in a way that would lock down some of the critical lanes on the tables.
Yeah, it's kind of interesting that there are a couple FDs, and if I am not, my eyes don't deceive me, no E-webs, which has been my opposite. I've had the opposite reaction where we see a lot more E-webs and a lot fewer FDs. So that was surprising.
Yeah. No E-webs in the top six. I think E-webs made it into the top 12, but I'll have to check the list again to make sure. So yeah, just like Han, I think they were there. They just didn't quite make it into that top tier.
I was impressed to see Jedi mind tricks on the top six. There was one on those lists.
And what's of these top six? What new tech from that specialist box was just barely legal for your guys' event? Was there a lot of covering/coordinated fire? Did we have a lot? Did we have any generic commanders running around? What kind of specialists were people taking? So maybe if you're just like me, getting your models painted, what do I need to try to prioritize working into my lists from the new box?
Actually, I did see a fair amount of specialists represented. I think the commander was probably the least common upgrade. The officer was there. The medic droids were there in a couple lists for sure. And, you know, the new cards are definitely seeing play. So I'm actually really looking forward to seeing the card breakdown, what command cards each player took. because I think that'll be really eye-opening. But, you know, I'll be perfectly honest. Even John Griffin, who took first place overall, said, you know, he had an okay coordinated fire turn here or there. I think Sean Morris got an impressive 20-plus aim token turn out of coordinated fire in his second or third round. And Sean went 3-1, so he does more than just make terrain, believe it or not. And so he was rewarded there, but I'll be honest, it was not something that decided.
Okay,
that
that's cool. All right. Well, any final thoughts on the LVO? I'm very looking forward to Orc's full write up of all the numbers and breakdowns.
I will just once again say, guys, thank you for being an awesome community, because I can spout, you know, my tournament for months and months on end. But if you guys don't show up, all I have is Fire Festival.
No, we didn't show up, so thank you, Internet Land.
Here. It's the community that keeps people in this game. It really is.
Yeah, you guys are the real MVPs, and you know the content creators of this game will work hard day in and day out when they know that you support them in the ways that you do. Yeah. And you know, I can't wait for Adepticon.
So, if you're telling me that one of the prizes might be, if you win Adepticon, you get to design a card. I mean, that opens up so much design space. I've got all these ideas.
No,
one
stop
is Hondo
it.
Anaka.
Stop
I want to
see
it. Hondo Anaka.
When Ben starts speculating, it's time to shut this thing down. We've got a great long episode. Thank you, LJ, for coming. Thank you to all our listeners for spending your paint table time, your commute, your afternoon, your evening, whatever, with us. We will see you guys hopefully in 2 more weeks. And I'm Ryan Slawoski, reminding you, more pizza gun, more power.
I'm Tim Hannon, reminding you to fake it until you realize you'll never make it, but then keep going.
I'm Lj Peña, reminding you to always yup your nub.
And I'm Ben Fowler, reminding you to paint your models like Sabine paints walls. That late 80s neon graffiti never goes out of style.
Have a good night, everybody.
Now I have to think. Oh, I don't like thinking. Oh.